Please join me in singing 10,000 Reasons to Bless the Lord.
Thank you.
God with shouts of joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of you.
And also with you.
My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sin and so confess our sins. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, what I have done and what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us of our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
And you this day are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify
you,
we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world,
receive our prayer.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone, the Holy One,
you alone, the Lord,
you alone, the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped up into the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand bright in the light of truth. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated for the liturgy of the word. Got some little ones coming up.
The first reading is a reading from the Book of Wisdom. God did not make death, nor does he rejoice in the destruction of the living. For he fashioned all things that might have being, and the creatures of the world are wholesome. There is not a destructive drug among them, nor a domain of the netherworld on earth. For justice is undying, for God formed man in his, to be imperishable. The image of his own nature he made him. But by the envy of the devil, death entered the world, and they who belong to his company experienced the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
His anger
lasts
drawn, rejoicing.
I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me.
Hear, O Lord.
Hear, O Lord, I have pity
pray
on me.
O Lord.
O child.
Well,
O Lord,
be my helper. You changed my mourning into dancing. O Lord, my God, forever will I give you thanks.
I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me.
Brothers and sisters, as you excel in every respect, in faith, discourse, knowledge, all earnestness, and in love we have for you, may you excel in the gracious act also. For you know the gracious act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that although he was rich for your sake, he became poor, so that by his poverty you may become rich, not that others should have relief while you are burdened, but that as a matter of equality, your abundance at the present time should supply their needs, so that their abundance may also supply your needs, that there may be equality. As it is written, whoever had much did not have more, and whoever had little did not have less. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please remain seated.
See
you.
Chanting.
Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Alleluia. 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 Our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed death and brought life to light through the gospel.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
My brothers and sisters, the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a large crowd gathered around him, and he stayed close to the sea. One of the synagogue officials, named Jairus, came forward. Seeing him, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him, saying, "My daughter is at the point of death. Please come, lay your hands upon her, that she may get well and live." He went off with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed upon him. There was a woman, afflicted with a hemorrhage, for 12 years. She had suffered greatly at the hands of many doctors and had spent all that she had, yet she was not helped but only grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up from behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. She said, "If I but touch his clothes, I shall be cured." Immediately, the flow of blood dried up. She felt in her body and she was healed of her affliction. Jesus, aware at once the power had gone out from him, turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who has touched my clothes?" But his disciples said to Jesus, "You see how the crowd is pressing upon you, and yet you ask, 'Who has touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. The woman, realizing what had happened to her, approached in fear and trembling. She fell down before Jesus and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has saved you. Go in peace and be cured of your affliction." While he was still speaking, people from the synagogue official's house arrived and said, "Your daughter has died. Why trouble the teacher any longer?" Disregarding the message that was reported, Jesus said to the synagogue official, "Do not be afraid. Just have faith." He did not allow anyone to accompany him inside except for Peter, James, and John, brother of James. Then they arrived at the house of the synagogue official. He caught sight of a commotion, people weeping, wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, "Why is this commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but asleep." And they ridiculed him. He put them all out. He took along the child's father and mother and those who were there with him and entered the room where the child was. He took her by the hand and he said, "Talitha kaum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." The girl, a child of 12, arose immediately and walked around. At that, they were utterly astounded, and he gave strict orders that no one should know of this, and he said that she should be given something to eat. My brothers and sisters, this is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. Amen. Welcome to the 13th Sunday in Ordinary. You're going to hear me the entire Ordinary season, because I do it every year. Say, "There's nothing ordinary about ordinary." But today I'm going to say the opposite. Today's totally ordinary. And intentionally so. I don't even know if I'll read that. The reason that it's so important that it be ordinary is because we're ordinary people. Right? I'm not the President of the United States. I'm not the Pope. I'm not a celebrity. I mean, there are celebrities out there. But whether your name is Jairus, and everyone knows your name, and you're elite in the community, in the high temple, right? Or whether you're a little named woman who no one knows your name, Jesus is with you, all of you. Whether you have the strongest of faith, fear and wonder of the Lord, or no faith at all, he is with you. But to be healed, you do have to have faith. So I'm going to speak to you and summarize all of Scripture as quickly as I possibly can, which is what we really should be doing every single week. He came because we needed it. We celebrate Christmas because all the prophets said he was going to come. They pointed to his coming, the Messiah, the resolution to the covenant. The judges before, they pointed back to the covenant. And they said, God said one day we would be together, that we would have all that we need to worship him in a right relationship, see him as he is, and that we would be a nation of priests. And Jesus, when he came into the world, was declared just the same. He is God who is with us and among us. He is God who saves. He is friend, neighbor, and king. Not the king you expected. Not like King David, not like the patriarchs before him, and not like any king who ever failed and came later. He is a king who said on his deathbed in the second garden, not the first, I am the new Adam. Love as I have loved you. Sacrifice. He's saying, I give you all that you need. They missed the point in the desert when he rained down manna upon them and told them, take what you need. There will always be enough. But only take what you need. We need Christ, and we only need him. He has always been enough. But we need to have enough faith, wondering all whether you have that faith like I do that says, I'm going to jump out of that plane, even though it's still a little scary, and not that fear that says, I might fail. I might not be good enough. Or I can't forgive. Because he says nothing is impossible for me. He created the cosmos. In our retreats, every time we do a retreat, we're going to do it again this year, I always show you a little video. It's real brief. And it shows you on the Earth, and it zooms out, shows how big the planet is, and how big the solar system is, and how big the galaxy is, and how big the galactic system is, and then how bad or big the flat is, the intergalactic system, and then how big the universe is, the known universe, and all that we don't know, and shows you just how tiny you are. And I would say, to the opposite of that, how important everything in it is. It's all connected. 100%. Every moving part matters. Would you agree that in a building, and we have examples of this that we're going to talk about today, that if you removed a stone, that it might crumble? Would you say in a ship that if you removed one of the planks on the bottom, you'd probably sink?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So every one of them matters. This is the ship. Did you know this is the ship?
Yeah.
This building?
Yeah.
This body? The Holy Catholic Church around the world throughout time, it's a ship. The Pope proves it. He is the captain of the ship. He wears two giant sails on his head. Every bishop through apostolic succession down through him wears the same hat, the same captain's hat, to say, we are not staying where we are. We are not meant to survive. Our job is to be great adventurers, to go beyond the horizon. To go to the other side. So when Jesus, last week, he tells them over and over and over again, he says, the point is to see me as I am, right here, to see God as he is, and to want to know that touching his cloak is enough for healing. Not asking for random help, but we're saying, I see you, you are enough. He says, it's not enough to understand. He says you need to know what love is. Relationships require communication, right? They require time in the church and with each other. Sometimes eating a dinner together, maybe the final dinner. Sometimes it's about taking care of each other, washing each other's feet. Sometimes it's about visiting the sick. Sometimes it's about going to church and reciting Isaiah like he did in the very beginning of Mark. Sometimes it's an understanding the power that Christ has in his name alone. To cast out demons, to quiet a storm, or to heal you. I told you last week, when we were talking about fear, that sometimes he will quiet the storm, but sometimes he will help you ride out the storm. Your job is to be in his presence, and to be him to the presence of others. That's why there's two tables. I told you guys that that love that we talked about was super powerful. I actually wrote a homily once upon a time that I've given you 100 times. I'm not going to give you the whole thing again. But we talked about, I'm going to pull them up for 2 seconds just so you can get a reminder. I told you about power love. I don't know how this one is.
Jackets.
I don't know why I had that. So there was a power to love. This part's important. I'm stopping these because there's a lot of them. It's because we have to believe that it is enough to change. Now, I will be honest with you, some of you fear change. But I said it is a love that is higher. It is a love that God literally says we must aspire to be more. He is seen and unseen. He is transcendent beyond our imagination, and he is right in front of you. Ordinary relationships are a part of him. Later in the Mass, you'll do this again. We do that because he says, pardon not your heart. This is his temple. This is the temple Solomon never built. He promises us that love is eternal. Last week we talked about him quieting the storm, and I said people are afraid because they think change is too much, it's too difficult, because we don't know what's going to come, right? We don't know if he's going to quiet the storm or if he's going to ride it out with us. Sam Cooke, love the singer, told us change is going to come. And you might go to your brother, and he might not help you. You might wander around and feel all alone, but you're not. This wonderful man, Mr. Withers, says you will sometimes be weak, and when you're not strong, lean on me. He says, I'll help you carry on. When you think you're alone, no, you're not. Call my name, and I'll stand by you. This one I love. He said, no matter how far you go, there ain't no mountain ever been too high, no valley too low. He quite literally said he would level both. Nothing separates you. Call me, I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry. I told you guys last week, I said, yes, Solomon was right. He did say the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, but not the kind of fear that makes you run away. It's the wonder and awe of all that's around you. The possibility that says, yeah, I could be president of the United States. It's going to be hard. It might not even happen, but it could happen, right? I might never go to Hawaii, but I might. I have. Go back. I might not want to jump out of a plane because it might be scary, but I can do it. It's possible to do it. But I can say the words of Elvis Presley. Wise men say, only fools rush in, but I just can't help it. Today, I want to give you the most modern example of what we saw in the gospel today. St. Mark, this little boy who was in that second garden, who was described as St. Peter, who was telling his story today, not just the story of the cornerstone, Christ, but of the rock, the foundation of the church, the church you're in today. He says, fear will come, but what do you do with it? Do you hold on to fear, or do you hold on to faith? Faith is hope that you cannot see. You have a choice. There was a movie I saw once upon a time, and I love this example because we talk about it in psychology all the time, too. Main characters' names quite literally mean to transcend beyond, to be transcendence, and to be new. Morpheus, Trinity, and Neo. It's the Matrix. In this story, Morpheus, he comes to the guy who's unaware. He goes to the other side, literally, And he says, Neo, things are not what you think. Life seems difficult, but it also seems ordinary and boring. I want you to see something. You all have seen something. You have seen hope. You know the power of love. You also know difficulty of this world. You've seen both. You can't unsee it, but you do have to make a choice. He says to Neo, you've seen it now. I give you a choice. I will give you a red pill. It's a pill of passion. Or I'll give you a blue pill. That difficult decision or the ordinary one. He says, you can take the blue pill, and if you do, you'll have an ordinary life. You'll wake up right now, and you can believe whatever you want to believe. You can do whatever you want to do, and you'll have an ordinary life, and you'll survive. Or you can take the red pill, the one that is uncertain, the one that is difficult, the one that is paramount. You can stay with me here in Wonderland and see just how far down the rabbit hole we can go. Amen. Please stand. Brothers and sisters, please turn to page 10, and together let us profess our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead.
He ascended into heaven
and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy
Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body,
and life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. God never intended us to die. He created us for life, but we chose death. Christ, our Redeemer, yet again restores us to life, and so today we come to our Father praying through him. And so we pray today.
That our Pope and bishops may continue to proclaim the good news of the risen Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That people in nations afflicted by poverty may be drawn to the Lord Jesus, who became poor for our sake, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who mourn the death of a child may be consoled by faith in the gentle mercy of our Savior, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our fear of dying may be replaced with trust in God's promise of salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our dear departed may be raised up to our eternal joy in heaven, especially... Let's pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Brothers and sisters, if you have any intentions, please make them known out aloud or in silence in your hearts.
Please pray for John Michael, who's having knee replacement surgery tomorrow, and for Tara Chestnut, who is a biologist on Mount Rainier and was crushed by a 500-pound boulder on Friday. She's had a couple surgeries already and has several more to come.
Lord, we pray today for Tara, and we pray for John. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the members of our church and their needs and their health and their emotional needs, and for Wendy, the continued recovery of her brother, that faith, and for the blessing of our new home. Thank you, Lord.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Can I pray for my nephews, David Michael II and Brock, because they're going to get to see their dad for the first time since the accident today.
Lord, we pray for their hope. We pray for their strength. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
To the poor people in Miami.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor people in Miami.
Lord, we pray today for our brothers and sisters who have suffered in Miami, Florida, from the terrible, terrible destruction of a building. We continue to pray for our brothers and sisters who lost their lives in a hot air balloon just recently. And we also pray for the little girls, for their community and for their families and for their teachers over in Alabama today. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We continue to pray for the strength of June, for Jack. I pray today especially for David, For Elizabeth, I pray for Amy. I continue today to pray for each and every one of you and your families. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
I ask for a special prayer today for our continued growth and for my father and his upcoming surgery. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We also pray for the strength of those who are on vacation, that they make it home safe with us, including you. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
All-powerful God, our lives rest always in your hands, trusting in your providential care. Today we bring our petitions before you, all through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Cross the barren desert.
acceptable to God the Father Almighty. May the Lord accept the sacrifice of singing for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his church. Let us pray. O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray, that the deeds for which we serve you may be worthy of these sacraments, these sacred gifts through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift our hearts to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being, and while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now we possess also the pledge of life eternal. And for having received the first fruits of the Spirit, for whom you raised Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in that same Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, and in joyful celebration we too acclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You're indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, and become for us the holy body and the holy blood of our Lord, your Son, Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, our Lord took bread into his holy and venerable hands. And with his eyes raised to heaven, to you, O Lord, his almighty Father, he said a blessing over the bread. And he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying to them, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. For this is my body, which will be given for you." Similar way, when supper ended, he took the precious chalice into his hands, and once more giving thanks, he said a blessing over the cup. And he gave it to his disciples, saying to them, "Take this, all of you, and drink of it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Of our faith. Christ
is
died,
Christ is risen,
Christ will come again. Please be seated. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks as you've held us to be worthy to be in your presence and ministry. Humbly we pray that partaking of this body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, that we be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, for Anthony, our Bishop, and for the entire order of bishops and all your clergy, remember, Lord, your servants whom you called from this world to yourself this day. And grant that these, who are united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. With the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Savior, Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse, with all the blessed apostles and saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, may we too merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and praise and glorify you through our Lord, your Son, Jesus Christ. Please stand. Please repeat after me. Through him,
through him,
with him,
with him,
and in him,
and in him.
God, Almighty Father,
O God, Almighty Father,
in the unity of the Holy Spirit,
in the unity of the Holy Spirit,
all glory and honor are yours.
All glory and honor are yours.
Forever and ever.
Forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.